Well, at least I hope, and I sincerely hope, that Hammond's got the message that he is not wanted. I'm looking for someone that will not sit down across the table and talk to Judge Starrick before he decides whether he should file a case or not. I'm looking for someone that the lawyers don't have to go by him before they can file a suit. If they see the need to file a suit for the poor, I think they should have their own prerogative to do so.
The Texas Vietnam Veterans Against War held a press conference in Arlington this afternoon. This is the same group that's held five such protests across the nation. Perhaps the one that received the most publicity was Operation Dewey Canyon 3 in Washington last April. In Arlington, they came to announce that the Dallas-Fort Worth area would be the subject of what they call a search and seizure operation. They being Randy Floyd, an ex-Marine captain and a pilot. He now lives in Austin. Terry DuBose, ex-First Lieutenant, U.S. Army. He too lives in Austin. And James Buck, who was a First Lieutenant and platoon leader in the Army in Vietnam. He goes to school in Arlington.
Texas Vietnam Veterans Against the War will declare the Fort Worth-Dallas area a free fire zone beginning at 0600 hours Friday, 4 September 1971. The company of 150 veterans will report in Friday evening to the initial staging area for primary briefings. We will convoy by vehicle to the assembly point in Trinity Park, Fort Worth, on Saturday morning. The company will cross the line of departure at 0800 hours, and in the free fire zone, all unfamiliar individuals will be considered hostile.
At 2 o'clock Saturday afternoon, we will proceed east on Highway 80 into Arlington. And by 5:30 Saturday afternoon, arrive at Randall Mill Park for guerrilla theater action.
Mr. Floyd, you mentioned search and seizure operations against certain federal buildings and federal bases. What does that mean?
Well, it's not actually going to be a search and seizure against the buildings themselves. The search and seizure and search and destroy is the tag we put onto most of the guerrilla theater operations we're going to do. And these operations will be planned and executed by the troops and civilian actors who are working with us. These are to show primarily the type of tactics used against the Vietnamese people in Vietnam.
Does it mean the blocking of access to the buildings?
No, it doesn't.
How many members do you have in the Dallas-Fort Worth-Arlington area now, and how many will take part in the demonstration?
We have approximately 150 in this area now, and there will be about 45 out of this area who will be with us.
I think, by and large, the people in this area of the country have no concept of what war is. Okay, we're trying to bring a concept other than a plastic television concept, something they watch for entertainment almost on the news, bring it down and make it real to them, make them realize that people, real people, are being tortured and killed every day in Vietnam. And basically just to make it real, that's all.
We are here primarily because of the agreement that has been in existence for a number of months between NIMH and the Bureau of Prisons, which permits us to move into the facility around October 1st. And even though there are continuing efforts in Congress to either delay or block this move, nothing specific has happened in that respect.
What will you do with the facility? How will you operate it? Who will be involved prisoner-wise?
Well, we will establish a federal correctional institution, and the special mission of the institution will be to serve as a drug treatment facility and a correctional research center. And we will retain more than 200 of the present staff, including psychiatrists, psychologists, social workers, and line personnel in order to assist us in this. And
Taylor Stadium in Waco, fourth stop on the 1971 Southwest Conference Press Tour, home of the Fighting Baylor Bears. Head coach Bill Beal, now in his third season here at Baylor, has many more reasons to be optimistic than he has in the past.
Actually, I think, of course, we've got some good football players. We don't have a lot of depth, but we're going to have a good football team because we've got these players now that's gone through our program for 2 years, and they understand what we're looking for. They've been conditioned to the type of football that we, you know, request that they do if they want to play for us here at Baylor University. And they've worked hard these 3 years. I've never been around any group of players since I've been coaching and worked anymore that put in more time and effort and this type of thing, and they want to win. So that helped.
How do you feel about Southall as a winning quarterback?
Actually, Cy, of course, would have been our starting quarterback about the third ball game his sophomore year, but unfortunately he got hurt, had a knee operation, and was out that season. And he comes back in the 70 season and didn't really recover fully from that operation. Plus, picked up a lot of weight, injured his shoulder in the first ball game against University of Missouri, and this presented a problem throughout the year.
Makes quarterback feel good to know that he's going to be healthy when he goes out there, doesn't it?
Yes, sir, it sure does. It makes a big difference. And, of course, our offensive line, we've got everybody backing it, and that makes you feel a lot better.
Would you be dropping back or sprinting out this year?
We're going to do a little bit of both. Of course, how the defensive ends play make a lot of difference. If you get a defensive end that's just a gangbuster coming inside, you're going to try to sprint out a little bit. If you got one that'll kind of feather you and not rush so hard, you're going to drop back. So game conditions are going to determine a lot of what we do.
Would you explain a little bit about any new offensive formations that you'll have in your backfield this year?
We're running our same offensive sets all the way down the line. I think we may go from the eye into split a little bit more because we've got a little more speed in the backfield, but as far as any big changes, we're not making any at all.
How does it feel to have that little more speed with White and Williams back there?
They're running off and leaving me. Our counter play, I think we're going to have to take that because by the time I fake to one of them, the other one's already gone.
What percentage of your plays will you spend in passing?
Of course, you try to get a balance there, 50-50. Again, game conditions are going to determine a lot of this. Our passing last year, a lot of it was when we get behind, we come in and try to break a ball game wide open with the long one. And I hope we don't get into this situation this year that we can go more with the short stuff and get a balance there with our two running backs that they're talking about now. Like you say, Godfrey and Matthew, maybe it'll take a little bit of the pressure off our passing game.
Godfrey, what different positions does Coach Beal have you playing here at Baylor this year?
Well, bow backer, fullback, and tailback.
Would you explain the duties of the bear backer?
Well, it's sort of wing back. You know, you slide out, you know, like a split receiver or something like that.
So you'll be catching passes from the barebacker position?
Yes, sir. I'll be catching sometime.
And your fullback duties will take you up the line?
Straight up the middle, outside.
Godfrey's a real fine running mate. He's quick, fast, and we're planning on spoiling a lot of teams this year with him.
Do you have any personal goals this year that you'd like to accomplish, Matthew?
Well, not really. It's very seldom I set a goal for myself. I just like to win. I've heard some running backs say that they'd like to rush over 100 yards. Well, any back would like to rush over 100 yards a game. But I just like to help the team in a way that I can. It doesn't matter if I just make 1 yard, you know, as long as we can win.
It's quite evident that Coach Beal's optimism is shared by his coaching staff and also by the players on the squad. And as a touring member of the press, it's felt also. It could be that this could be the year Baylor Bears. From Baylor Stadium on the campus, Jerry Haynes for Channel 8 Sports.
Start of the first Girls Club of Dallas culminates several years of hoping, dreaming, and planning on the part of many Dallasites. These people had long awaited a girls' club which would provide social, recreational, and educational outlets for school-age girls living in the disadvantaged areas of the city. West Dallas was chosen as the site of the first girls' club. No longer will girls like Pamela and Penny Berrigan have empty field days, days of doing nothing, standing on unsupervised playgrounds, hoping. But now they will have supervised recreational facilities available. They will learn constructive arts, something that they can use later in life.
I think this facility is one that strikes at the morals, one that gives the kind of background to a youngster that's most essential in developing real good tenets of citizenship.
Spokesman for Girls Club of Dallas has given Christmas Day as the target date for opening of this facility. Councilman George Allen, one of the principal speakers at the groundbreaking ceremony, summed it up pretty well. He said, Dallasites sometimes refer to West Dallas as the stepchild of the city. However, the opening of this facility has been the first step in a series of making this a full-fledged member of the family. After all, girls are important. Gene McIntyre for Channel 8 News on the move.
I don't have a prepared statement right now, and I really hadn't thought about much to say in response to what happened yesterday. But suffice it to say, I'm not quitting.
The pickets say they gave you 31 days, and that was ample time to prove yourself. What is your response to this, and what do you feel their chief complaint is?
Again, not really too much prepared statement. I'm just not quitting. There's a lot that I have to do administratively and to get this office in the shape where I think it would function a lot better. That was the purpose of my trip to San Antonio. But I'm working closely with the judges and the bar, and I'm going to try to meet with the people in the target area.
They seem to think you're more attuned to the people in the bar, the judges, etc., than you are to the poor people themselves.
Well, I'm older. Let's put it this way. I practiced law for 15 years, and it's I know what I'm doing.
The picketers say they'll stay till September 21st, and James Hammond says he'll stay on the job, too. So now it's up to the full board of the Dallas Legal Services to decide who will win out. Ethelyn Gilbert did say her group would support Hammond if the board does. For Channel 8 News on the Move, this is Judy Hanna.